In any case, please turn with me to chapter 11 of this wonderful book, Proverbs. Verse 24. One man gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous man will prosper. He who refreshes others will himself be refreshed. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. Let us bow our heads and hearts in prayer. Lord God, in your word you invite us that if any of us lacks wisdom, we should ask you, who give generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to us. We do lack wisdom, especially, Lord, of the kind that is your wisdom, a wisdom that is not just simply baptized common sense, but is instead utterly uncommon sense, the uncommon sense of generosity, as we will reflect on it this morning, of loving, of giving ourselves in surrender to you to accomplish your good and perfect will through us. We pray that you would do so. Fill us with your spirit afresh. May we worship you as you deserve, in spirit and in truth. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. This morning I want to turn to a subject that is without doubt the most embarrassing, the most awkward topic for any of us to speak about. And I'm not referring to that other subject. I'm talking about the subject of personal finance, of what's in your wallet, of how you conduct your financial life. It is really interesting, isn't it, that human beings will share, well, nowadays, through the help of Facebook, but in personal conversation, they'll share details about their lives, well, details that you wouldn't even really necessarily want to know about. On every other aspect, every other dimension of their life, but the last thing they will ever share with you is how much they earn, how much they have in the bank, how much they owe, although sometimes that will come out if they're hoping for some help, and how they spend their money, how much they give to charity, or any other related topic. It's just so intensely personal, so private. Even in families, we don't share this kind of information. A few parents have been bold enough in the history of mankind to share the facts of life with their children, but almost nobody shares with their children the other facts of life with respect to financial life. If Junior is asking for a brand new bike, of course, parents do not hesitate to say, no, we can't afford it. But they never then take the opportunity to then open up the books and say, well, you see, Billy, this is how much your daddy earns every week, and this is what mom brings home. And here are our fixed expenses, and you can understand we don't want to end the month in the red, and so we have to portion things. And so here's how we're budgeting all of our expenses and even our fun money, and this is what we're giving for the work of Christ and to other charities, and we just don't do it. And there are good reasons. I'm not necessarily encouraging you to somehow or other overcome that instinctual reticence. I think there are good reasons for it. We don't share these things openly because, well, we probably are rightly guessing it might cause unpleasant emotions on the part of the person listening. Some of them may pity you, and you just don't really want to be an object of pity. Or perhaps they'll envy you, and so this becomes a barrier in your friendship. Or maybe it'll be an invitation to some flim-flam on their part. Who knows? You know, I did have the experience not too long ago just sharing with our children that Janie and I were thinking of going back to the lawyer and updating our wills now that we have children. And that's a joke, you know. I won't explain it, but in reality, it's not a joke. I mean, it was a humiliation to realize that the wills did not anticipate that we would be having kids. But in any case, the response back on the phone was a spelling lesson. My son said, be sure, it's N-O-A-H, in case what we were doing was dealing with our wills. Anyway, you don't really want to tell people about these private matters because of the impact it might have, but we need to know about it. Praise be to God that he has given us so much help, practical help in these areas of our lives in his word. And praise God, too, that there are within more intimate contexts of small groups, even within this church, those where there has been enough trust developed where individuals will share issues with respect to sexual temptation with one another for their prayers and help. And also, I've heard about one group of older individuals where they actually opened up all the facts about their financial lives because they wanted each other's help to maintain some real accountability in being faithful in the stewardship of their material lives. Anyway, that's what I have in mind this morning for us to talk about. We've been in a summer series of sermons on the theme of fatigue. You've heard a message on church fatigue and another one on serving fatigue. There's been one on compassion fatigue. There have been a couple that I preached on battle fatigue, the spiritual warfare in which we are engaged. And this one, I suppose, would be under the rubric of giving fatigue. What is in your wallet? What is the wisdom of God with respect to your stewardship over it? The Bible emphasizes these things. This topic is not shied away from. Howard Dayton, a graduate of Cornell and one of the founders of the Crown Financial Ministries that we make use of in this church, he writes in his book, Your Money Counts, that there are some 2,350 verses in the Bible on the subject of money, how to earn it, how to spend it, how to save it, how to invest it, how to get out of debt, and I actually plan to speak on that subject next Sunday, and I particularly want to address topics like the fact that being in debt is no excuse for not being rich. In any case, and then the subject of how to give it away, which is more the topic that we are going to be addressing this morning. The devotional author Richard Foster, the well-known author of Celebration of Discipline, many have read, I know, in this church, he claims that Jesus taught more on the topic of money than on any other subject other than the kingdom of God. 40% of the parables that Jesus preached, for example, have as their implication lessons for our financial lives and stewardship, often used as an analogy to then make a deeper spiritual point, but nevertheless with great implication that's very practical for us. And why would this be? Well, the reason is that because the first commandment is thou shalt have no other gods before me, and the greatest sin throughout Scripture then is invariably the problem of idolatry, of putting something in the place of God, allowing something to be a rival to what should have been the unrivaled lordship of the God of heaven and earth over my life, over your life. And it turns out that money has an unfortunate tendency to become an idol. In fact, Jesus uses a personal name that he invents for money when it has become an idol. He calls it mammon. It's actually related to the Hebrew word for amen, which we say. And it actually means, mammon means the thing you put your trust in. The thing you put your trust in. He said, no servant can serve two masters. Either will he hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and mammon, referring to money. In our Pew Bible, they just translated money with a capital M. But it's money when it has become an idol and therefore personified. And why is it an idol? Why is it like God? How and what ways does it act like God? Well, for some people, it sets the priorities of their lives. Well, only God has a right to tell you how to live your life. But for many people, it's money. For money also challenges God's right to tell us the worth of our lives. A lot of people have made the mistake of allowing their bank account, their wealth, to be that which determines their sense of self-esteem. The fact that they get paid so much for this or that job. Well, only God has a right to set your self-esteem based on the fact you are his creature. He made you in his image and likeness, and he gave his only begotten son for you, so you are of infinite worth in his eyes, and so you should be even in your own. Money is often used as a means of judging others. If they don't seem to make very much, we don't make much of them. Well, what right have we to do that? We're judging another man's servant. It's only God who has the right to let us know how precious that other person is in his eyes. A lot of times people likewise make the mistake of allowing their money, their wealth, to be the basis of their sense of security. So they're anxious when the accounts are low, and they feel a false sense of security when, well, the investments are doing okay. But our trust shouldn't be in wealth that's fleeting, and in a moment everything can turn topsy-turvy. It should be in the God who provides richly for all of our needs through Christ Jesus, our Lord. In any case, the Apostle Paul talks about how we as believers need to put to death whatever belongs to our earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. When money is now running your life, it's an idol. And if it's an idol, it's an idol from which you and I need to be converted if we're going to follow Christ. The reality is, what we do with our money is an enormously accurate index of our affections, of our love. Our Lord Jesus once said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And it's kind of a feedback loop. If you put your treasure where it belongs, well, then your affections will follow. But it's also the case that where your affections are, that's where you tend to put your treasure. And no one is fooled otherwise. I mean, we can tell it. If you happen to have some interest in that gorgeous young lady that has caught your eye, and you're now mustering after having dated for some while or whatever, you know, that you're trying to pop the question. And sure enough, you happen to go to the dollar store, and they're having a sale on, you know, cubic zirconia engagement rings for, you know, $25. You know, you feel like you got a good deal. That shows your frugality. You can emphasize that. But will it have the impact on that lady that deserves everything you are and have and can give her as a potential husband? Will it have the impact you desire? Or ought you rather to go to Tiffany's or to, you know, some other real jeweler and get, of course it's going to cost a ridiculous sum of money, $5,000 maybe for a 1 or 2 carat diamond. But, you know, she's worth it. Right? That's what you want to communicate. If you love, it isn't about, you know, frugality. It wouldn't be enough just to happen to find a diamond ring and say, you know, I happen to be walking along the common and no one claimed it, and here it is, honey. Would you marry me? You know, it's not the diamond itself, it's what it costs. And that which costs you nothing will not adequately express your love. David once said that about his offerings to God. I will not offer to the Lord that which costs me nothing. It was great that he had the opportunity perhaps to buy a field in Jerusalem at a cut-rate price, but he wanted to pay top dollar. This is going to be for the Lord. The love of money or living for money is a false religion from which you and I need to be converted if we want to live for Christ. And so discipleship means at the very start letting go of that clenched fist, letting go of that which we think we own to recognize the proprietary rights of Jesus Christ over that and everything else you have and are. In fact, one way of describing the life of discipleship is that we've got to say goodbye to it. In the same way, any of you who does not, well, Jesus said literally, renounce or say goodbye to everything he has cannot be my disciple. The word that is just sometimes translated renounce, you have to renounce everything, is the literal word for say goodbye to. On another occasion, we read, an individual said to Jesus, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my friend. It's that very same word. It's often occurred to me that in baptisms, particularly of adults, it would be an interesting addition to have us, just before we apply to the water, have the man or woman who's come to faith hold up a wallet and say goodbye to it. You know, and once you've said goodbye, you've let go. Now, that doesn't mean that Jesus is calling, you know, Christians into an order of mendicants, that we go everywhere begging, that we... It does mean, however, it's now held in an open palm. It's now at his disposal to use as he sees fit, as is true for everything else that we have and are. All of our gifts, our education, our privileges, our jobs, it all is laid on the altar for him to use as he sees fit. We say goodbye to it all. In the case of the rich young ruler, we know that Jesus actually told him that he has to not just say goodbye to, but get rid of. He looked at the rich young ruler, one thing you lack, he said, go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and then come follow me. Jesus was very clear that it wasn't going to be a loss to this man to give it all away. No, you're going to get riches you can't even comprehend. You will have riches in heaven. You'll have treasure in heaven. But somehow or other, the man didn't get it. His myopic vision was concentrating on the dreadful costs, as he perceived it, of giving up everything. But it's not that Jesus always requires that. He just required it of that man because that man had a problem. When Zacchaeus came down from the tree, he declared, I'm going to give half of my possessions to the poor. And Jesus didn't say, oh, no, that's not good enough. We're not going to have any 50% disciples here. I can't tell you exactly what percent God is telling you that you actually have to get rid of. But I can tell you, you have to say goodbye to it all. You have to take your leave of it all and hold it now only in an open palm for him to use as he sees fit. Paul in the Apostle says in 1 Corinthians 7, what I mean, brothers, is that the time is short. From now on, those who buy something should live as if it were not theirs to keep, and those who use the things of the world as if not engrossed in them. For this world in its present form is passing away. It's a reminder to us of our responsibilities as stewards of all that which God has given us. Paul tells Timothy, command those who are rich in this present world. Oh, there are rich Christians, and there were in the first century. What are they to do? Well, they're to say goodbye to everything, and then, as Jesus tells them, distribute it according to his will, paying bills, investing in farming investments, and doing whatever he has in mind, or giving it to the poor. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. It's not like God is a skinflint. He has showered us with blessing. and taken care of not only our needs, but actually many of our greeds, it would seem, but to be used in his interests under his authority. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. And in this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. Lots of people are trying to make a living, but they don't know how to make a life. You want a life? You got to turn to the giver of life, who's Christ. And it may mean giving up a lot of the living you thought you were making, as he then takes charge over your financial lives. What do you have that you did not receive? And if you received it, why do you boast as if you did not? If you received it all, it's all just his. And if it's all his, then we're in the position that David was in his valedictory address to Israel, and after just on the verge of abdicating the throne to his son Solomon, charging his son with building the temple, which was the next project God had in mind. And then David inviting everyone to join him in contributing to the building of that temple. And he then prays this in 1 Chronicles chapter 29. He says, "Who am I and who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this?" This is his prayer to God. "Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand." It's all his. "We're aliens and strangers in your sight, as were all our forefathers. Our days on earth are like a shadow without a hope. But, O Lord our God, as for all this abundance that we have provided for building you a temple for your holy name, it comes from your hand, and all of it belongs to you." You know, later on in the service, you're going to have a chance to put that into practice during the offering, when you put in whatever you choose to put in. But as you do it, at least have that heart attitude. "Lord, all of this comes from your hand. It's all of, it all belongs to you. And it represents everything else that belongs to you that for whatever reason you intend for me to keep and use in some other way. But it's all yours." I remember Larry Richards' materials as an early Christian reading in Luke chapter 16. You know, I have to admit, I'm not like really into economics. I don't really like having accounts and doing the family budget. It's not like my favorite time of day. But I now have come to realize, and Richards and other materials have really helped me to see this, when Jesus in the parable of the unjust steward in Luke 16 says this, he says, "Whoever can be trusted with very little," referring to our money, our pocketbook, our bank accounts, "whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth," that's the little, no matter how big your accounts are, it's little in God's eyes, "who will be trusted with the true riches?" That's the big thing that comes based on how well you do with the little. "And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property," that's the worldly wealth, it all belongs to God, "who will give you property of your own?" That's what God is promising us in eternity, to entrust us with riches that we can't even comprehend. So it's a test. What we do is a stewardship. It's a test. And it matters to God how you do it. How you pay your bills matters to God, even though it seems so mundane, so minor, or even annoying. It matters to God. Do it for him. So also our generosity, which is all part of that stewardship, not only our fidelity in paying our bills, the hard work that we give to God as a means of earning our income, all of that matters to him, but so it does our generosity, which is, of course, the focus of our text. Now, you know, I was tempted with preaching on the basis of the needs of the church. So, you know, it wouldn't be wrong. Earlier this morning, for the third Sunday in a row, our air conditioning system in the sanctuary failed. It's 40 years old. It needs to be replaced. I was drenched in sweat. It was just so unbearable in here. Thankfully, it seems like they got it fixed once again. So we could talk about needs like that. Or the missions program. Here this Sunday, morning, we've already sent out 21 of our men, women, and children for a wonderful short-term missions project of 12 days to Colombia, working in an orphanage and an English camp. And it's, and we can talk about other, you know, the other, well, Winter Duncanson, who will be commissioned right after at the end of this service to be a global professional. It's worth investing in that missions program. But I don't want to talk about the church's need. I want to talk about my need and your need. Your need and my need to give generously, not just to the church, but to family, friends, employees, co-workers, those in need, to the work that Christ is calling us to do. To all, our need to be generous in all aspects of life, including giving to charity and to church. And our text stresses you can't outgive God, it turns out. One man gives freely, we read in Proverbs 11, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous man will prosper. He refreshes others, will himself be refreshed. This is not common sense. This is uncommon sense. This is God's wisdom, not man's wisdom baptized. God's wisdom that only works in a universe where God is in charge and he's the one who makes it happen. And interestingly, it starts with a heart of generosity that he's giving you and giving me. Now, we're all a work in progress. We're not there yet, I admit. But we love because he first loved us, the Bible says. If you're a believer, a follower of Christ, I know something about you. I know that on average, you are much more generous than you were before you came to Christ. And on average, all of those who are God's people are doing a better job than they would have been if they weren't followers of Christ. Now, some of us have a little more to go than others. Others, a little less go. But it's all this perception of what do we have that we did not receive. And suddenly now we've put it at Jesus' feet, and I know what he's going to tell us to do with it. You can't outgive God. And so, empirically, it turns out, you can actually measure this. I've shared this on another occasion, but Arthur Brooks, professor of public administration at Syracuse University, and now a social scientist, anyway, with his blockbuster book, Who Really Cares, subtitled America's Charity Divide, Who Gives, Who Doesn't, and Why It Matters, he really, well, he surprised himself. He was a registered Democrat, a liberal, he's studying the whole issue of who is actually supporting all these wonderful charitable institutions, whether we're talking about universities or the MFA or PBS or the Democratic National Convention, or you know, who's paying the bill? Who's in trying to make a scientific study of the characteristics of those who give generously. He discovered, to his shock, that there are two Americas, and we're not talking about red states and blue states, or the rich and the poor, or the inner city and the suburban. It's the givers and those who don't give. And it turns out, he discovered, 91% of those who attend a house of worship regularly, whose faith is at least important enough to them that it inconveniences them. How many were inconvenienced to come to church this morning? Of course. It costs, doesn't it? You could have been doing anything, you know, out on the golf course or who knows what, right? So it costs you something. If your faith is as important as that, so that it costs you something, so you regularly, not every Sunday, but not once a year either, he defines it rather loosely, but regularly attend a house of worship, 91% of you regularly donate to charity, compared to 66% of those who do not regularly attend a house of worship. 91 versus 66. Is that just an accident? Coincidentally, the average household income of both groups, this is measured in 2005, is about $49,000 a year. It's the same. Both groups are earning, on average, the same amount of money. And yet one, 91%, the other 66%. And it turns out that despite the fact they are averaging the same amount, those who give to the charitable causes, the religious people, on average give four times as much as those who do not regularly attend a house of worship. Interestingly enough, he also found out that the religiously motivated givers also give more to secular charities than the non-churchgoers. They give 16% more, are more likely to give to charities like United Way, Cancer Society, and so on. And they give 14% more money. I mean, just monetarily, their gifts mean more. Same way with respect to family. You should pray that your parents come to Christ, because it turns out that family members who are regular churchgoers apparently are 8% more likely to give to family and friends over the previous year, and the average value of those gifts is 46% higher. So, you know, this is going to renew your prayer for the family members, I know, I can tell. Anyway, of course, Brooks' book has been critically reviewed. Some have argued that he failed to take account of confounding variables such as cost of living. After all, we all know that those who live in the expensive Northeast tend to be less ardent churchgoers than those who live in the Bible Belt in Mississippi, which happens to be one of the most charitable states in the Union. But it turns out that defenders of Brooks have tightened up the research, and in fact, it turns out that if you survey those, if you get two people identical in every other way, age, gender, marital status, education, level of household income, and place of residence, so we're not talking about differences in cost of living. If you factor all that stuff out, so they're now identical, the religious person is 23 percentage points more likely to give than the non-religious person, 26 percentage points, by the way, more likely to volunteer. So it's not even just about money. It's also about time. Steve Jobs, toward the end of his life, said, "It's really clear that the most precious resource that any of us have is not money, but time." And it turns out that the real leveler, when you look at Mississippi versus Massachusetts or any other comparisons you want to make, the person who regularly is attending church is giving far more time, at least twice as much, for voluntary causes, helping out, and secular ones, not just religious ones, the PTA, the Boy Scouts, trying to raise money with the neighbors for Cancer Society, and so on. They're also twice as likely to donate blood, and that doesn't cost any money. That has nothing to do with cost of living. It has to do with a heart of giving, a generous spirit. All I can say, it's remarkable. It turns out that the Holy Spirit is alive and well and actually helping us, apparently, to love as we have been loved, to give as we have been given. The social scientists still doubt it. And so they suspect other confounding variables. Another one they posit is peer pressure. That if you attend church regularly, you're going to be embarrassed into giving, shamed into it, because if you're stingy, you'll be feeling very out of place. That's because the social scientists don't go to church. They don't know that doesn't go on in any church that I know of. We are not a secular organization. We have no plaques anywhere that say, you know, Bill and Sally are giving at the platinum level, and then there's those at the gold, and then I know a few of you are at the paper level, you know, down here. We don't point that out. None of the ministers, as a matter of fact, in this church, and it's often the case in most churches, I think, none of us knows what anyone gives. This is all a matter of total confidence in terms of the office management. They know, and that's the only person. I don't know what you give. I don't want to know. I don't want you ever wondering whether I'm being a friend just because I have a hidden agenda of some kind. And you don't want that either. But mostly, I don't want to cheat you out of the real blessing that is yours. The Lord Jesus, we're all very well aware, said that when you give to the needy, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. We don't want to deprive anyone of that. And so we don't apply any pressure. We don't embarrass. We don't shame. In fact, it wouldn't matter even if we tried, because we cannot coerce, we cannot manipulate, we can't even measure the value of your generosity in the way that God does. The only way that counts. And it's not cash value. Jesus, as he looked up, saw rich putting their gifts in the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins, maybe pennies, two pennies. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. He said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on. How can we measure that? How can we shame people into that? It's a matter of the heart. It's all about love. The gift is acceptable, the Apostle Paul says. I know you're feeling a little embarrassed. The offering's going to come. You're thinking, I don't have anything with me. Or maybe if I give anything, I'll default on, or you know, the house be repossessed or whatever. The gift, if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what he does not have. God is measuring our generosity according to our hearts. And God loves only one kind of giver, a cheerful giver, not one who is under compulsion. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion. For God loves a cheerful giver. It's all about our love for him. It's the diamond rings that we're giving to the lover of our souls, or it's whatever you, whatever. We're like Mary pouring out the costly ointment on Jesus' feet that's worth more than anything because of what he's done for us. Well, there is a boomerang effect that our text emphasizes. One man gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous man will prosper, but he who refreshes others will himself be refreshed. You know, it doesn't seem like that, does it? I mean, after all, if you have $1,000 and you give away $100, now you have $900. Isn't that less? Doesn't it now mean you have less, that you're now poorer than you were before? Well, of course, that's the way our arithmetic measures it. But in terms of Scripture, there are riches that most people cannot possibly imagine. And those riches are what we want for you and God wants for us. It's the riches that aren't just matters of bank accounts. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you through his poverty might be rich. There's a lot of riches that are not accounted for when you're being audited, and the ones that really count are the ones that come from Christ. And there's a richness and reward. You get more than you ever give when you give in the heart of love to others. It's a remarkable fact how love gives back, how you benefit yourself almost, ironically. Well, it's like what Paul says, he who loves his wife loves himself. It all comes back to you if you do it with the heart that God intends, the heart of love. And he will take care of you, don't worry. Even in material terms, even right now. Paul writes about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 again. He who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should do what he has decided in his heart. Not reluctantly or under compulsion, but God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, he's even going to take care of your needs. I'll admit at times he takes care of them by making you flourish with less. I mean, the rest of the world can't live on 100% of its income. It's grumpy about it all and anxious. And we're flourishing and thriving on just 90%. So sometimes it's making us enjoy that secret of contentment and relishing that which he allows us to have. And other times he actually multiplies what we have. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of your crops, and then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. He takes care of the need because he knows what you're going to do with it when he blesses you. You're a good investment when you're the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. God will provide. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you as well. Now I want to talk about, in a few minutes, about right now, about where the generosity is to go. What are we talking about? And I want to emphasize, this is not all about giving to church. In fact, if that's all you're thinking of, you've got the wrong idea. He wants it all. And he wants the generosity to cover all. And so I would insist the first generosity you'd be needing to pay attention to is generosity to your family and to your friends. If one does not provide for his relatives, we read in 1 Timothy chapter 5, and especially for his immediate family, he's denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Paul at another point in 2 Corinthians 12 says, I'm going to come and visit you for a third time, but I don't want to be a burden on you. It's not your possessions I want, it's you I want, he says. And then he says, and after all, children should not have to save up for their parents, but parents for their children. Spiritually, he's their parent. All he really wants is their love, like any parent wants from the child, right? You just want their love. But you'll bankrupt yourself for them. And it's easy because you love them. You can even convince yourself that their college education really is worth $40,000 a year. And if you test, it's probably better not to test how much they're learning. But, you know, you'd like to believe it's so, but it doesn't matter. You'll do it because you love them. You'll do it. And then what do you say if you don't have $40,000? Janie, just last week we were going through her parents' house and cleaning out a few more things. And she came across the wedding gown. I mean, people drop a lot of money on weddings for their children, don't they? This was a wedding gown her mom sewed by hand because, well, they didn't have the wherewithal to go out buying some fabulous dress, and it brought tears to her eyes. And then we found we had a tiered cake, you know, the wedding cake and the reception. She handmade the wood on dowels, little pillars of dowels on which the cake would rest in order to be a tiered cake. And you just, I mean, of course, you know, if someone else could buy, well, that's fine, it can buy. But, you know, time and loving attention and care is not missed on your children. They get it. It's the kind of it, saving for our children, giving to them. That's what it's about. Generosity toward our children rather than being skinflints and begrudging and grumpy about their demands on us. It's the way of showing love, isn't it? Generosity in business relationships. Make it the case that the workers in your company, if they're working for you, are the envy of the neighborhood because of the way you generously compensate them. Make sure, especially when people are in service occupations or self-employed and caring for you in your needs, that you pay close attention to this. The Old Testament tells us in Deuteronomy, do not take advantage of a hired man who is poor and needy. Pay him his wages each day before sunset because he's poor and is accounting on it. I had the privilege for 23 years to pastor a church where most of the members were self-employed carpenters and painters and sheetrock people and those who were tile workers and electricians and plumbers, and they love their work. They're amazingly gifted at their work. The one part about their lives they hated the most was giving the estimates and having the customer try to beat them down. They were fair estimates, but they were made to feel, you know, like they were somehow or other crooks or something because of all the arguing and the haggling, and then the difficulty in getting paid afterward. For whatever reason, it just seemed like, well, Proverbs 3 says, do not withhold good from those who deserve it. When it's in your power to act, do not say to your neighbor, come back later, I'll give it to you tomorrow, when you have it now with you. Don't, you know, play this game. They had to play the suppliers, when they put those pipes in. Why make them be stuck with the bill? Pay them now so they can't wait for the next time you ask, and pay them more than they charged. And get a reputation for the generosity of God's people that will be carried far and wide. When waiters, maybe you can't afford to eat out very often, but when you do, make it a joy to the waiters. Thank them, be gracious to them, and give them a more generous tip just in case they notice that you said grace before your meal, or they overheard a conversation with your friend about the Bible study you're in. Then they'll realize, hey, I hope we get more Christians in here. In the taxi cab driver and all the rest, be generous about it all. Don't try to beat them down. Proverbs 20 says, it's no good. It's no good, says the buyer. And then off he goes and boasts secretly about his purchase. He doesn't give you the satisfaction of knowing what a fair price it is. He's trying to, oh, no, you kidding me? This isn't worth that. But goes home and boasts about it. That's hateful. Why not be generous and say, ah, that's fine price, and here's a little bit more for your time. In any case, God wants us to be generous. Generous toward those in need, for sure. How if anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Our church has a deacon's fund that helps us in this way to care for those in need within our community. The one thing I warn you about, as I've been often warned by those who are caring for the homeless in this city, by those at Boston Rescue Mission and Salvation Army and other organizations, be respectful. Be attentive and caring. Shake hands. Have conversations with panhandlers. Maybe even take them out for a cup of coffee, but don't give them money. All the organizations are begging us, do not give panhandlers money if you want to help them. That will help you feel better. It will not help them. If you really want to help them in a way that will help them. Give it to the Boston Rescue Mission or the Salvation Army or any one of these other organizations. Make the generosity wise and counting. And what about toward God? One man gives freely, yet gains even more. You get it back. The Apostle Paul directs the church at Corinth in 1 Corinthians 16. He says, now about the collection for God's people, do what I told the Galatian churches. This is for everybody. Those churches, your church. This is the word of God, universal, Paul is saying. On the first day of every week, that's which day? Everybody? What day? What's the first day of every week? Sunday. Say that again. Sunday. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income, saving it up so that when I come, collections will not have to be made. Well, what's that about? Well, it's about how our giving should be proportional, habitual, and worshipful. Proportional, in keeping with his income. Your giving should be proportional, in keeping with your income, because it's out of gratitude. It's all God's. And you think back when you put that money in the plate, or think back, how has God blessed you this past week? In proportional to his income. The Old Testament, this is just alluding to it, in Deuteronomy 16. No man should appear before the Lord empty-handed. To come empty-handed is to imply God didn't give you anything, that he hasn't blessed you in any way. It's ungrateful. Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you. We give not because the church needs it so much. We give it because we need it. It's not that God's a charity case either. We give it because we need it. It is a way of expressing in our worship what God deserves from our lives. Each according to his ability. To whom much is given, much is required. Oh, we could talk about tithing. I've preached about that in the past. Early in my Christian life, I thought, what's this 10% thing? And, in the ancient world, it was a very rich symbol. 10% was what every king imposed as a compulsory tribute on every people who are subjects to him. That's it. You give your tithe to whoever's the king of your life. We have that from inscriptions from Ugarit at the time of Moses. We have it from the time of the Babylonian captivity, the Neo-Babylonian inscriptions. We have it from Carthaginians right up into the New Testament period. All across the ancient world, a tithe was that which you give to the king that rules over you now. And so God's people, who were to have no king other than the Lord, had this expression where they gave one-tenth of that which they... So that was the proportion. I found that a little hard at first, never having given a nickel away. And so, you know, I was looking for books that would say, well, the tithe is no longer required. Unfortunately, every book I found that said what's required of us is more than a tithe. So I'm sort of back on the tithe thing. I think at least a little more manageable. But anyway, it's, you know, all I can say is C.S. Lewis says, I'm afraid the only safe rule is to give more than you can spare. It's just a reminder, it should be costly because we do not want to give to the Lord that which costs us nothing. If the wedding ring is $2,000 and that's a huge chunk of your annual salary, that girl is going to be clear on how much you love her. If you make $2,000 a minute, then your wedding ring had better be a little more costly than that. It's in proportion to how he has blessed us. And it should be regular on the first day of every week. Why? Because on every week we have this occasion which we get to reflect on what God has done for us and what we are asking him to do for us to come with. It's not just once a year. And worshipful, it's the first day. It's the day of resurrection. It's the day when we are most impressed with what God has done for us in giving us Christ, who rose again from the dead on the first day, and whose appointment with his disciples was met on the first day. That's when he met with them in groups. And then the week later, he met with them again in a group. And then, well, and then in the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul at Troas meets with the disciples with the resurrected Lord now in glory, and again meets together to break bread because Christ is really in our midst. The Bible nowhere mentions in the New Testament a second day of the week or a third day a week, and there's no mention to of a fourth day, or no passage says a fifth day. It's the first day because it's the day of resurrection. And so this first day and next Sunday on that first day, and everyone, don't lose the opportunity of the offertory. Don't just pass the plate. I know that, you know, how many here have a checkbook with them? Raise your hand. You're my people. Like all three of you. It's just a, we're like a, you know, soon we'll be in the Smithsonian. How many here have a smartphone? iPhone. Oh, look at, I mean, it's, yeah, we are changing economy. And if you have a smartphone, you're used to using it and you probably don't even have any cash. I don't know. Or you prefer electronic fund transfers, and that's fine. But when the offertory comes, do this instead then. You know what a first fruits offering is? That's when the farmer just took a handful of wheat, a massive big field, and gave that to the Lord to represent what was going to come later in the harvest. You do a first fruits gift. Put in a dollar if you have it, a quarter if you don't have a dollar, a penny if you don't have a quarter, whatever you, and say to God, this represents everything you have showered on me this past week by way of blessing. Thank you. And with this, I give myself. Don't lose the opportunity. When we sing a hymn, don't you sing it? When we say the Lord's Prayer, don't you pray it? Why waste time during the offertory? Let no one appear before the Lord empty-handed. The Old Testament repeats that many times, and we have a chance. And Paul, apparently, even in the New, says, on the first day of every week, put a penny in and say, this represents the giving of my life to you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that we can put into practice your word, but mostly that we can worship you when we are most aware of our debt to you. We thank you that you indeed are worthy. You are worthy of everything we are and have. You're worthy of all praise and honor and glory and wealth and all that we can place on the altar and more. May we do so with glad and generous hearts. In Christ's name, amen.